Good evening, everyone. Happy midweek. We are now in the third part of our series, Why Are We Still Here? And you know what? Each night, I'm getting more excited as how will God unravel things to us that will happen in the end times. And most especially, as how it will depict the things that will talk about not what we can do, but what God can do in the end times. Because in the end times, it will not be about us, but it will be about God. It will be the one who will deliver us. He will be the one who will seal us. He will be the one who will make a great escape from this great tribulation that we are going to face in the end times. Because the end times is not about the crisis, but it's about the Christ. It's not about the tribulation, but it's about God's restoration. It's not much about the signs, but it's about Jesus Christ. Yes, we might know the sign, but if we don't know the Lamb or we don't know Jesus Christ, we could still be lost in the end times. Tonight, I am excited because we are going to talk about the greatest drama of Earth's history. And here we can find the most amazing things that will happen in the darkest night of the evening, the darkest part of the evening of the Earth's history. Here we are going to see that beyond the darkest part of the evening, we could find also the greatest light that will come. And that is no other than the great deliverance of God. Tonight's topic will be packed up with many things. Because we are going to discuss about the mark of the beast, the seal of God, seven last plagues, great tribulation, great time of trouble. There will be many things that we are going to talk about tonight, and I hope by the grace of God, it will help us not to fear it, but rather to cheer when we go our way to the end times, because we have the assurance that God will be with us. Tonight's topic is entitled, God's Who's Who. God's Who's Who. Who will be gods in the end times? Who will be classified as one of the foolish? Who will be classified as one of the wise? So tonight, we are going to talk about God's Who's Who, the great deliverance. Here comes now the drama of the last hour of Earth's history. There will be dense darkness in this time, and it will come deeper than the darkness of the night. But you know what? Unexpectedly, there will come a shout which God will proclaim His words, "It is done." And then heaven will open for each one of us. I'm excited. I'm very excited of what we are going to talk about tonight because this will be the climax of our series and it will prepare us for the culmination tomorrow night. And hope that you will not miss tomorrow night. Because if there would be one more thing that would be the most exciting, and that is no other than tomorrow night, dare not miss it. Because we are going to talk about the wonderful reward of God for us. But before anything else, shall we bow our heads as we seek the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, as we behold the fading hours of the earth's history, we ask, dear God, that you may hedge around us your walls of fire so that when these tribulations will come to us, we'll be found among the people whom you will prepare as your bride. May we be found the end-time people, dear God, that will be found holy, blameless, not partaking the abomination of the harlot. So I pray, dear loving Father, that you may continue to seal us and pour out your Holy Spirit in us, dear God, that we may be found protected and sealed in the end times. Tonight I ask, dear Lord, for the Holy Spirit to guide us in our topic tonight. May your name be magnified, be glorified, and your voice be amplified. May this experience tonight help us never be the same again. And we look forward to that end time with great cheer and great rejoicing, knowing that in a little while, we will be going home. Thank you for the assurance of all these things. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Open your Bibles with me to the book of Titus. Here we are going to start it with the blessed hope. What would be your hope? We are still here. Where will you place your hope in the end times? Where will be your hope? Some people say, why we still have our breath? We still have hope, right? But some people, though they still have their breath, but they do not already have their hope with them. So where can we place our hope in the end times? It says here in Titus 2, verses 11 to 13, for the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world, looking for that what? Blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify unto himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works. These things speak and exhort and rebuke with all authority. Let no man despise thee. This is where we are going to place our hope, in that blessed hope, in the great appearing of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And I assure you that in the end times, upon the darkest part of the night, we could find that great appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ. If we are placing our hope in Him, we could find that thing will be a great joy for us. Though the world will find its great terror, will find its great horror, but it will be our great honor when we behold that thing. Let us place our hope in that glorious appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ. Tonight, as we continue in our series, we are going to go back in our parable, from the parable of the 10 virgins in which we derive our series. Here, it is talking about the preparation of the church in the last days. These are the preparations of the church as we are heading towards the time of Jesus' soon return. Open now your Bibles with me to the book of Matthew 25. Verses 9 and 10. You know what? When I found verse 9 and 10, I found something amazing here. Why is it mentioned in this parable? It is not mentioned in some other parable, but it is mentioned here. Have you noticed? It says here, but the wise answered, saying, not so. Why? Because they are being asked of the oil. Lest there be not enough for us and you, but go ye rather to them that what? Sell and buy for yourselves. And while they went to what? Buy. I would like you to notice here. I would like you to notice the succession of the event here. It says there, and while they went to buy, the bridegroom, what? Came. And they that were ready What is the word? They that were ready went in with him to the marriage, and the door was shut. You will find that in these two verses, it is packed up with many things. And you can find that these things are going to happen in the end times. Have you noticed the things there? It says they will buy to those people who are selling. Where can you find a resemblance of this passage? Where can you find in the Bible a resemblance of this passage in which people will come to a point that they will buy and sell? Where in the Bible can you find that? Before we go on that, I would like you to notice that to have given the foolish virgin sufficient oil, it would be what? It would be a great problem for the wise, because we have talked about last night that we could not share our Holy Spirit experience. Character is not transferable. One Christian cannot do for another that which he must do for himself in preparation for himself in the coming crisis that lies ahead. So it tells us here that may we not be found in that situation in which we are going to buy and sell. Because you know what? It would be a great terror. It would be a great horror in the earth's history. And I would like you to notice, I would like you to follow with me, where can we find that in the Bible? That in the earth's history, we can find a scenario in which people, all the people, will be what? Asked to buy and sell. And you know what is the scenario? Let us find it in Revelation 13. Revelation 13, verses 16 and 17. And it says here, and he causeth all, how many? Some? No, he causeth all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a what? A mark in their right hand and on their foreheads. Now, some people say that there will come a time that people will what? Put microchips in your what? Forehand and your forehead. And some people also say that we will be receiving barcodes. And some say that those barcodes, you can calculate it and you will what? Find 666 in it. But did they notice that the 666 here, it's not really about a number, but it is the character of the beast. It is the character of the beast. That's why in the end time, God would not like us to buy and sell, because it would be a very terrible thing to receive the what? The character of the beast. This would be a very terrible sin in earth's history. That's why we need to be filled with the Holy Spirit in the end time. We need to receive the latter rain so that it would protect us to receive the mark of the beast. And that would help us to receive the what? The seal of God. But I would like you to notice first that the seal of God will not be shown right away in the end times, in the great tribulation. You know what? It will come in the latter part when the clouds will open. When the clouds will open and people who receive the mark of the beast will see a scroll open into their very eyes, and they will find the Ten Commandments, and there they could really see that the seal of God is no other than the Sabbath. It will not be in the time that the tribulation is happening that we will see the seal of God, but we will be sealed by God. Okay? But in that time, in the peak of the tribulation, we are going to see the clouds bearing the scrolls, proclaiming the seal of God. And then those who receive the mark of the beast will regret that they have rejected the seal of God. They have rejected the Sabbath. The Sabbath of the Bible. The Sabbath of God. Now, my dear brothers and sisters, for us to notice these things, for us to be prepared in these things, we need first to see the sequence of the end time, the sequence of the events that will happen in the end times. Let us see one by one what is going to happen so that we will know where are we indeed in the end times. Why are we still here? Because we are not still seeing such things, some of those things. But you will find that many of the signs of the times are already what? Being seen in our very eye, in this generation, in our time today. Now let us see the sequence of events that will happen in the end times. Notice number one, as it was said in Revelation 14, 6 and 7, the first event, the first sequence of event that will happen is no other than the preaching of the gospel. The three angels' message will be proclaimed into all the world, into nations, to every tongue, every kindred, and people. It will be proclaimed. Praise God that Matthew 24, 14 will be fulfilled. Amen? It will be fulfilled. It will come to the outskirts of the world. It will come with great glory that the three angels' message will what? Will reach the ends of the world. Who will proclaim this? God's people, God's messengers in the end times. The proclamation of the gospel needs to happen. Number two, the next sequence or the next event, I would like you to notice that after the preaching of the gospel, the tribulation will come. The angels in Revelation 7 will now be what? Will be blowing their winds. What is the representation of these winds? I would like you to notice chapter 7. I would like you to see this. And after these things, I saw four angels, what? Standing on the four corners of the earth, holding the what? Four winds of the earth, that the wind should not blow on the earth. Because what happens here, when the wind is supposed to be blown, the three angels is supposed to blow it, but you know what? The fourth angel is rushing. Wait. Please, hold it for a moment. Please, hold it for a moment until we seal the people of God in their foreheads. And have you noticed that God in His chain of command will work through His angels in the end times? So it will not really be about us, but it will really be about God. And with all His splendors, with all His angels, will work for us in the end time. Can you see how God is so good? That this thing will really not touch those who have been prepared in the end times. Those who chose God. Those who have God in their hearts. They will hold the wind. And I would like you to notice what also would happen. As they are holding the wind, the sanctuary will also open at that time. What does it mean? That while the winds are being held, sanctuary open. In other words, at this moment of time, in that period of time, Jesus is now interceding for those who repent, for those who confess their sins and trust in Jesus Christ. We can enter the sanctuary by faith and claim the merits of Christ's sacrifice now in that time, but the day is coming when the sanctuary will be closed. What it's trying to point here is that the probation is still open for us. We can still confess our sins. We can still repent. Lord, please forgive us from our sins. While the winds are still being held. God is really merciful. That in those last hour, we could somehow experience the 11th hour experience of the thief on the cross. Some may receive their salvation at that time. Some may receive forgiveness at that time because the sanctuary is still open. Why? Because in the sanctuary, you can find salvation. Because the one who gives salvation and who brings salvation is in the sanctuary at that time. It is still open. That's why, my dear brothers and sisters, it is very important now to listen to the Word of God. Because listening to the Word of God is a matter of life and death. I am serious with this. Because I would not like to come to a point that your blood will be placed upon my heads. Because I was not able to share to you the truth that will happen in the end times. That's why, as we are still having our worship, as still we are having those meetings in the church, we need to listen to the gospel. We need to hear the voice of God. We need to heed the Holy Spirit. We need to be what? To be filled by the truth. Because time will come that what? The sanctuary will close. The sanctuary service will close. And that is what we call the close of human what? Probation. It will be the close of probation. That's why in Revelation 22, verses 11 and 12, it says here that what? He that is unjust, let him be unjust still. And he which is filthy, let him be filthy still. And he that is righteous, let him be righteous still. And he that is holy, let him be holy still. And behold, wow, what comes next? And behold, I come quickly. And my reward is with me to give every man according as his works shall be. That's why when the close of probation, God wants that people will be sealed by God. That's why He has given a time to withhold the winds, so that we could still be sealed. Because those who will not receive the seal of God will receive the what? Mark of the beast. The mark of the beast. And you will find in Revelation 15, verses 5 to 8, it says here, and after that I look, and behold, the temple of the tabernacle of the testimony in heaven was what? Open. And the seven angels came out of the temple having the seven plagues, clothed in pure and white linen, and having their what? Breasts girded with golden girdles. And one of the four beasts gave unto the seven angels seven golden vials full of the wrath of God, who liveth forever and ever. But I would like you to notice verse 8, and the temple was filled with the smoke from the glory of God and from His power, and no man was what? Able to enter the temple till the seven plagues of the seven angels were fulfilled. In other words, no one could enter because at this time, the temple will now be closed. And it will now give the last plagues. They will not let the what? The angels blow its wind. They will now pour out the seven vials having the seven last plagues. Because the next part of the sequence of the end times is no other than the tribulation and the seven last plagues. And you can find that in Revelation 16, 1 to 21. Now, there will be seven devastating plagues that will fall upon those who have the mark of the beast. Watch out that this seven last plagues will not touch the people of God. But it will only be for those people who reject the seal of God. And they have received the mark of the beast. Isn't it a good news that we will be protected in the end times when we receive Jesus Christ, when we receive the seal of God, when we receive His sealing in us? That will be our protection in the end times. I thank God. I thank God because this work will not be for me or will not be by me, but it will be by Him. And I am rest assured that in my weakness on those signs, that in my frailness at that time, God's strength will be my sufficiency. It will be my strength at that time. Now, these seven last plagues will happen with those who receive the mark of the beast. Now, notice with me, the seven last plagues. If God will pour out the seven last plagues, how could you reconcile that with the character of God as love? Could you still recognize that God is love at that time? Yes. You know why? Because by this time, enough time is already been given to the people. But people still reject the word of God. Still reject God. Still, they have rejected the truth. They have rejected the seal of God. They have rejected the word of God. That's why at this point of time, they will receive the mark of the beast. And then, the seven last plagues will be given them because of their what? Rebellion against God. Because they have turned their back against God from time to time, again and again, from another opportunity to another opportunity, they have turned their backs from God. That's why I would like to make an appeal for you. You might not be interested in worship nowadays, but you know what? Time will come that this would have its great bearing for us. Because you know what? God is inviting us in every meetings that we have. Please receive me, my daughter. Please receive me, my son. There's no other else. There's no other else that I could take control in your life than you to let me take full charge in your life. Worship might be boring at this moment, but you know what? In the end times, worship will be the greatest test of loyalty. Who do we worship? Is it God? Is it the lamb, or is it the lamb-like beast? That's why, my dear brothers and sisters, my friends, this is God's mercy, actually. This is God's mercy. These seven last plagues are God's mercy to the world because it needs to end so that it will be renewed. So that He could now give, He could now what? He could now bring the new heaven, He could now bring new Jerusalem here on earth, so that we will stay with Him forever and ever. But these things still need to happen. You know what? I would like you to notice that in the seven last plagues, what will happen is this. Those who receive the mark of the beast will be used by Satan, not knowingly, that they will be the one who will what? Who will hurt the people. They will be the one who will be the channel. They will be the one who will be the means of the seven last plagues. That's why it is very dangerous that if we don't receive God now, how much more then? I could not imagine myself, I am rejecting God right now, and then at the end time, I will be the one who will persecute you. Because I have received the mark of the beast. God forbid. God forbid. God forbid. Now, I would like you to notice one by one how these people who receive the mark of the beast will experience it and at the same time will be the channel of it. Number one, the first plague, you will find that in Revelation 16. Verse 2, it says here, "And the first went and poured out his vial upon the earth, and there fell a noisome and grievous sore upon the men which had the mark of the beast, and upon them which worshipped his image." This is trying to tell that your physical security will not be enough in the end time. So that they will say to those who receive the seal of God, you will not be physically secure, but actually they are already receiving the what? The great and noisome sores in their body. Actually, this is not great. These are just what? There is just a pinch of what will happen, because it says it will be noisome. In other words, it will really be what? It will be really be painful. You will really groan for it. Number two, the second plague will happen according to verse 3. It says, "And the second angel poured out his vial upon the" where? "The sea, and it became as the blood of a dead man, and every living soul died in the sea." And this is what is going to happen. Sea will turn into what? Blood. Sea will be turning into blood. And somehow, this is a scenario in which people will what? Shed blood at this moment of time. Because sea, a representation of what? Multitudes. So there will be a great shedding of blood at this point of time. There will be great persecutions. And you will find out this is going to happen. This is how it will happen. And another thing, another one is this. Another one is this. According to verse 4 to 8, that the next one and the third angel poured out his vial upon the rivers and the fountains of what? Waters. They will say to those who receive the seal of God, your water will not be enough. Your water will not be sufficient. Your God will not supply for you. But actually, they are the ones who are experiencing it. The third one is that what? Rivers will also turn into blood. Rivers will also turn into blood. And I would like you to see how this source of what? Thirst or quenching of thirst will turn into blood. And those who receive the mark will suffer for it. We'll suffer for it because you know what? God will provide water for us. God will provide water for those who receive the seal of God. Number four, another thing that will happen according to verse 9, it says here, "And men were scorched with a great heat and blasphemed the name of God, which had power over these plagues, and they repented not to give him glory." I would like you to notice why it says that it blasphemed. Because the fourth one is this. It is the scorching of the sun. In other words, at that time, the origin of pagan worship will happen. And those people who are worshiping the sun will say that your God will not protect you. They will now be giving what? Sun worship at that time. They will now be proclaiming sun worship at that time. But you know what? Those who are sealed by God, they will still say that it is not the Son that we are worshiping, but rather than the Son of God and the Son of righteousness. This will happen, the fourth plague. Number five, the fifth plague will happen. According to verse 10, it says, "And the fifth angel poured out his vial upon the seat of the beast, and his kingdom was" what? "Full of darkness, and they gnawed their tongues for pain." What is the fifth plague that will happen? There will be dense blackness. There will be terrible darkness, darker than the darkness of the night. That's why you would notice we have learned from the first night that the earth's history will come to its fading hour. And then it will what? Escalate and escalate. Its darkness will escalate and escalate. According to this, it will be at the same as this. There will be terrible darkness because you know what? People will say at that time, those who receive the mark of the beast, we have the truth with us. We have the truth with us. But not knowingly that what they have is not the truth, but what? Darkness. Thinking that they have the light with them, but what they have is darkness. But according to what we have learned last night, those who will receive the Holy Spirit will what? Raise their torchlights. Will raise their torchlight and will light the way for the second coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. And that is very amazing. How I would love to see that. That when the darkness in its greatest deepness will also, what? Be consumed by the light in its greatest light, in its greatest brightness. God will show indeed His glory in these end times. Number 6, you will find also that Armageddon will happen at the time. The battle of Armageddon will happen. What does it mean? We are going to go back in the Old Testament, especially in the book of Judges, in which it says that there will be what? The people will be surrounded and they will be surrounded with doom at that time. But you know what? In the midst of that darkness and doom, God has delivered them miraculously. In other words, in the battle of Armageddon, in that end time, in that time, God will deliver us miraculously, in which we could not comprehend on our own minds. We could just see, wow, praise the Lord, this is a great miracle. How could this happen? Because only God can do it. Only God can do it. And you know what? I thank God because the last plagues is in which God will now see that sin will find its limits. That He will see now the limitation of the rebellion of sin, the rebellion of Satan, the rebellion of those who receive the mark of the beast. And then God will what? God will blow His words in according to Revelation 16 verse 17. See, saying now, it is done. We will hear it as an earthquake. Actually, it will be like an earthquake to those who receive the mark of the beast. But to those who receive the seal of God, it will be clear. The words will be clear saying, hearing from the word of God saying what? It is done. It is done. And you know what? In the same time as we are going to witness the seven last plagues, the greatest time of trouble in history of the world will also happen. The great time of trouble, I would like you to notice Matthew 24 verses 21 to 22. The greatest time of trouble in earth's history is going to happen. At the same time, you will now see the succession of events. Are you now seeing the drama of earth's history at this moment? Now let us see Matthew 24, 21 to 22. It says here, "For then shall be what? Great tribulation, such as was not since the beginning of the world to this time, no nor ever shall be. And except," I thank God because it says what? "And except those days should be what? Shortened." Should be shortened. "There should be no flesh be saved, but for the elect's sake, those days shall be shortened." This great day of tribulation is also mentioned in Daniel 12, verse 1. Daniel 12, verse 1, and it also amplifies the good news that amidst the great tribulation, I would like you to see the main person that will help us, the main person that will stand up for us, the main person that will stand in our behalf, and that is no other than Michael. And it says here, "And at that time, who shall Michael stand up? The great prince which standeth for the children of thy people, and there shall be a time of trouble, such as never was since there was a nation even to that same time. And at that time, thy people shall be what? Be delivered, everyone that shall be found written in the book. And I could say, amen, because it is God who will stand in our behalf. You know what? It says that it will happen as to the time that there was never, what? A nation. What does it mean? It's the same time as in the beginning, as in the book of Genesis. It will be what? Void. It will be empty. It will be as if that there will be really great tribulation for those who receive the mark of the beast. But you know what? It is the same thing that God will say, let there be light. And there will be a great light. There will be a terrible light. There will be a magnificent light that will happen at the time. And you will see the glory of God. You will see, we will see the glory of God. It says here in the Great Controversy, 635, paragraph 2, what? The people of God, some of you, some of us might be in prison cells. Some of us, what will be hidden in solitary retreats, in the forest and in the mountains, still plead for divine protection, while in every quarter companies of armed men urged on by hosts of evil angels are preparing for the work of death. It is now in the hour of utmost extremity that the God of Israel will interpose for the deliverance of His chosen people. Amen? That's why in that darkness, in that greatest darkness, God will say, what? It is done. And that light will happen. The great deliverance will happen for God's people whom He has chosen. For God's people whom He loved. For God's people whom He has made prepared for Himself. That's why it is no wonder that the rapture idea is setting up upon the Christian mind for only an overwhelming surprise. Why? Because the rapture idea is telling us that in this time, we will not prepare for the tribulation because we think that we will be what? Caught up. And then we'll go to heaven and not face tribulation. Well, actually, it is not the scenario that will happen in the end time. We will face tribulation, but we will what? We will surmount the tribulation because God, Michael, will send in our behalf. It will not be something that we will escape with. And then you will see, oh, where's Johnson? Oh, where's Roy? The tribulation is going to happen. Where are they? They have been raptured. No, it will not really happen. You know, have you now seen the scenario here? That God will not make heaven an escape. But rather it will make God. It will show that in the end times it will be about God. It will be about Him that will work in our behalf in that time. That the tribulation will not be a what? It will not be a fear for us, but it will be a cheer because we will not what? Receive those plagues. We will not receive those great tribulations, but it will be for those who receive the mark of the beast. Though we will be challenged, yes, but God will stand in our behalf. But one more thing I would like you to notice here. That who will be these people who will receive the seal of God? And it also mentioned in Revelation 6, 14 to 17, that these people in the end time will be a very, very unique people. And it says here, according to verse 14 to 17, and the heaven departed as a scroll when it's rolled together, and every mountain and island were moved out of their places. and the kings of the earth, and the great man, and the rich man, and the chief captains, and the mighty man, and every bondman, and every free man, hid themselves in the dens and in the rocks of the mountains, and said to the mountains and rocks, fall on us and hide us from the face of him that is seated upon the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb. The question is, for that great day of his wrath is come, and who shall be able to stand? The question is, who will be able to stand? Who will be these people? Who will be these people who will be able to stand in the end times? Who will be these people that will be sealed by God in the end times? It is no other than, you will find the answer in the next chapter. And it says, according to verse 4, and I heard the number of them which were sealed, and there were sealed on what? 144,000 of all the tribes of the children of Israel. The critical question of this thing is that the second coming of Jesus is portrayed, and then the question is asked, who shall be able to stand in the devastating outpouring of the wrath of God without mixture of mercy? The answer is no other than the 144,000. Now the question, my dear brothers and sisters, who are these 144,000? Would this really be the literal Israel, tribes of Israel, as it is mentioned here, according to verse 4 up to verse 8? Some thought that this will be the literal Jews in the end times. This will be the literal Israel at the end time. And some will say that it will really be an exact numeric status, 144,000. Yes, it is mentioned here that according to the tribes, that they will have how many according to each tribe? 12,000 each. Why it is mentioned that there will be 12,000 each? It is only trying to portray that God is trying to see, or God is trying to what? Show to us that according to each of those tribes, there will be not better and there will not be less or worse. There will be not more than and there will be not any less important than all of those. In other words, all of them are important to God. That is the first thing. Another thing is this. Could this be the literal count, or could this really be a literal number? And if you would notice, it says here that John heard the number. Would you like to count it? Ah, I heard it. 1, 2, 3, 4. Could you really make it at a basis that it would be a literal 144,000? No. But rather, as the same thing in the what? In the book of Revelation, there are numbers that are mentioned like 7 million. But it is really exactly a 7 million? 7,000. No, it is not. But rather, it is a symbol of message. It is a symbol of message. It only tells that this 144,000 represents, it has been foreshadowed in the time of the Old Testament, that there will be 144,000. It is not the literal Israel, but it is what? It is the spiritual Israel. One more thing I would like you to notice, that this will be a symbol of God's people in the end time. This will be the number of God's people. It is telling us that this number is not intended to convey mathematical information. It is not a statistic. Rather, as with numbers in the book of Revelation, the number itself is the message. It is a message that there will be a number of people that God will seal at the end time. You know what is the good thing there? We can count it. We can count that number. That's why, oh, when the saints go marching in, oh, when the saints go marching in, oh, I long to be in that number. When the saints go marching in, it will be counted, but not literally with the same as 144,000. And I will be the 144,001. I will not be included. No. It is only portraying that this is a what? A symbol of God's people in the end time. They will be counted. They will be counted. And I would like each one of you to be counted also when the saints go marching in. I would like to be in that number. Because you know what? This 144,000 will follow the Lamb wherever they are. Will follow this another. What it's trying to say is that they will have devotion to God in the end times. While those who don't receive the seal of God will what? Be following the Lamb-like beast. The multitude obeys this. While the people of God will obey God. And at the same thing, in Ezekiel 9, that the Israel that time is going to the abomination of the harlot. And God said, what? I need to mark the people of God. And that mark is a foreshadow of what will happen in the end time, and that will be the seal of God. What is the meaning of that seal? Because in the end time, it will also be the same thing in that old time, saying that there will be a great destruction in Jerusalem. But there should be a people that will be marked, that will be protected, that will not partake the destruction of Israel or Jerusalem. It's the same thing in the end time, that they will not what? Partake the destruction of the world. Because they receive the seal of God. You know what? By stamping God's seal upon us or upon them, God is saying, these are mine. And I will protect them from the devastating events of the tribulation. These are my people. They are the ones who receive me. So it means that the sealing of God is a victory for God and a defeat for Satan. The end time 144,000 are God's shout of victory. He is saying, see, I have my children back. They are all there, and they are all there in full strength. The number 144,000 means that God has achieved His purpose of preparing an end-time people for Himself whose loyalty is unwavering. He has prepared His bride and made her holy, cleansing her by the washing with water through the Word. In the 144,000, He presents her to Himself as a radiant church, without stain or wrinkle or any other blemish, but holy and blameless to God. That's why it says in Matthew 25, verse 6, and at midnight there was a cry made, behold, the bridegroom cometh, go ye out to meet him. Who will be this 144,000? They will be the people of God in the end times. They will be the one who will meet the bridegroom. And how could we meet the bridegroom at that time? Matthew 5:8 says, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall what? See God. And it's only telling us that what? If we are having violence in our heart right now, if we are having illicit sex in our hearts right now, if we are having pride in our hearts right now, if we are having jealousy in our hearts right now, if we are having all of this pride of all these things, these secret things in our hearts right now, how could we see God? How about your movies? How about your music? Is it hindering you to see God? We need to have these materials that will help us to see God rather than make us blind to see God. Am I communicating something here? Because they said that they will be loyal to God rather than the world. And you know what? I found some amazing material as to what it says, who are these 144,000? And I found it very connected to what the parable is telling us. It is from Lauren Wade, Thoughts on the 144,000. Journal of the Adventist Theological Society, 1997, page 92. I would like you to notice what he says. They are what? They are what? Virgins. The Old Testament prophets often compared God's people to virgins. They also said that worshiping false gods was just the opposite, like visiting a prostitute. They remain loyal and faithful to their promised bridegroom. Amen? There will be a midnight cry. They will be prepared to meet the bridegroom. They will be what? They will preserve themselves to meet the promised bridegroom. They are virgins. And by God's grace, may we be found of those wise virgins in the end time. And you know what's amazing? What is even more amazing, that at the midnight, it says in Great Controversy 636, paragraph 2, in the midnight, it is at midnight that God manifests His power for the deliverance of His people. The sun appears, shining in its strength. Signs and wonders follow in quick succession. The wicked look with terror and amazement upon the scene, while the righteous behold with solemn joy the tokens of their deliverance, because God will deliver them. Everything in nature seems turned out of its course. The streams cease to flow. Dark and heavy clouds come up and clash against each other. In the midst of the angry heavens is one clear space of the indescribable glory, when comes the voice of God like the sound of many waters, saying what? It is done! It is done! God will say, it is done. It is enough. I need to bring my people home. I need to bring my people home. That's why at that time, God will deliver His people. According to Revelation 19, 11 to 16, you will find there that Jesus Christ and His army will come to this earth to rescue His people. And you know what? At that time also, as the sanctuary service closes, God moved out from the sanctuary because He is going to meet His bride. He's going to meet His bride. Revelation 7, 16 to 17, it also tells that He will lead us unto living fountains of water. While some of us will somehow be thirsty, God will provide what? Living waters, fountains of water for us. It also says that in Isaiah 33, verse 16, that at the time, though we might be hungry, there might seem to be no food at that time, but you know what is the promise of God according to Isaiah 33, verse 16? He shall dwell on high. His place of defense shall be the munitions of rocks. Bread shall be given him. His waters shall be sure. Amen? You need not to worry the end times, because there will be an angel delivering special bread for you. There will be an angel who will be delivering special, what? Hidden spring for you. Silver spring for you. That will be from the fountains of the living water. And one more thing I love, it says in Zephaniah 3:17, I really love this scenario. I really like this one, because it says in Zephaniah 3, verse 17, Zephaniah 3:17, it says there, the Lord thy God in the midst of thee is what? mighty. He is mighty to save. He will save. He will rejoice over thee with joy. He will rest in his love. He will joy over thee with singing. God wants to hear you sing. When the what? The waves are crashing around you. At the tribulation, God wants to hear you sing, and he will be your song in that time. He will be your song amidst the darkness. He will be your music amidst the tribulation. God will be our song. Another one, it says, Lauren Wade says, they sing God's song. This is another evidence of the bold, what? Public character of their testimony. There is nothing muted about it. The verse says that their song is like the roar of rushing waters and like a loud peal of thunder, according to Revelation 14:3. The same way also, as God says in Psalm 46:1-3, what? God is our refuge and strength, a very, what? Present help in trouble. Therefore, when the earthquake, when the waters be removed, we will not fear, because God will be our refuge and strength. And another one, in Psalm 91, this will be our greatest refuge chapter in the end time, because it has promised us what will happen in the end time. And I hope that we could memorize this by heart. Psalm 91. And I would like you to notice some of the verses here. It says here what? He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the what? Shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. Surely he shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence. He shall cover thee with his feathers, and under his wings shalt thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler. I like what it says. Thou shalt not be afraid for the terror by night, nor the arrow that flies by day, nor the pestilence that walketh in darkness, nor the destruction that wasteth at noonday. 1,000 shall fall at thy side, and 10,000 at thy right hand, but it shall not come nigh thee. Because God will be our refuge and strength. He will be our very present help in trouble. There will be a refuge. There is refuge in Christ in the end time. There is no boil that can afflict you in the plagues. Nobody can take your life, because your life is in Christ. The sun cannot scorch you, because you are worshiping the Creator rather than the creation. In Christ, you will not be engulfed with darkness if you follow the light of Christ. The battle of Armageddon will not destroy us, but rather it will be our victory party in the end times. In Christ, all demons and hell cannot hold you when Christ comes, because in Christ, we can be more than conquerors. Jesus' arms will be around us, and his grace will be sufficient for us. As he descends from the clouds, he will then say, "It is done, it is done, it is done. Let us go home. Let us go home." And in Great Controversy 636, it says that amidst those darkness, while tribulation, while persecution is happening, you know what? There will be an unexpected light from the sky. And then it says here, what? By the people of God, a voice clear and melodious is heard saying, "Look up! Look up!" And lifting their eyes to the heavens, they behold the bow of promise. The black angry clouds that covered the firmament and parted and like stipend amidst the persecution, though we are stoned, we could see heaven open. We could see heaven open like stipend. They look up steadfastly into heaven and see that the glory of God and the Son of Man seated upon his throne. It will be like this. You will find that amidst the tribulation, amidst the darkness, amidst the persecution, amidst this terrible darkness, this terrible plagues that will happen, there will be a rainbow that will surround us. What is the rainbow represents? Ezekiel 1:28, in other words, it is representing the glory of God. While we are experiencing those trials, while we are experiencing those tribulations, the rainbow will cover us, will embrace us. That's why no tribulation shall touch you. No tribulation shall touch you. And then Jesus is coming to receive us. Jesus is coming to receive us all. Isn't that a good news? This is the great deliverance of God. Today, my brothers and sisters, let us keep ourselves by the hands of God to be made pure, unspotted from the world. Because if you want to be in that number, when the saints go marching in, let us indeed let Christ take his full charge in our lives. My friends, might be some of you have heard this message before and it's been a fearsome for you. But now I would like you to know it will not be fearsome. The end time will be a great joy for us because it only tells that Jesus is coming. Jesus will bring us home. He will bring us home. And as we listen to this beautiful music, may we ponder more upon this thought, Lord, would I be ready to receive your seal? Am I ready to receive the seal of God? May I be found each day prepared as if Jesus will come tomorrow, prepared as if Jesus is coming today, as if Jesus is coming right now. By God's grace, may we be found so. My dear brothers and sisters, may we be found so. And as we go on this, listening to this beautiful music, when you hear those words, I need you to talk to your God at this moment. And then talk to Him in your preparations in the end times. Lord, is it fear or is it cheer that is with me right now? Talk to Him right now if we are indeed prepared. Talk to Him to prepare you for the soon coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Talk to Him to prepare you for that great tribulation.
The theme of the Bible is Jesus and how He died to save men. The plan of salvation assures us He's coming back again. Are you ready for Jesus to come? Are you faithful in all that you do? Have you fought a good fight? Have you stood for the right? Have others seen Jesus in you? Are you ready to stand in your place? Are you ready to look on His face? Can you look up and say, this is my Lord? Are you ready for Jesus to come? Don't cling to the world and its treasure. The earth will soon pass away. Oh, give in your love without measure. He's calling you today. Are you ready for Jesus? things to come. Are you faithful in all that you do? Do you fight a good fight? Do you stand for the right? Do others see Jesus in you? Are you ready to stand in your place? Are you ready to look on his face? Can you look up and say, this is my Lord? Are you ready for Jesus to come? Are you ready to stand in your place? Are you ready to look on his face? Can you look up and say, this is my Lord? Are you ready for Jesus to come? Can you look up and say, this is my Lord? Are you ready for Jesus to come?
There is a father who brought his child to its school. And then before parting, the father have said, my child, please take good care. I will come back. I will fetch you. I will come back for you. And then they separated. When the father went to his work, when he's sitting at his office, he found out that the lockers are shaking. The tables are shaking. And then it is getting worse and worse. And now they were able to find out that there is an earthquake. So they rushed outside. And then they saw the building crashing down because of the earthquake. And the very thing that the father remembered is his son. It's his son. So he went to the school. Unfortunately, the blocks had already been piled up. The school is already destroyed. And he went to the top of those blocks of rocks, those pile of rocks, and then one by one, he's picking stone and stone from stone to stone. It took him 4 hours. It took him 6 hours. And then people are trying to say, are you crazy? Get down. They're already dead. But it's as if he has not heard anything. He's still picking up souls. He's still picking up rocks one by one. Now the ambulance came. The fireman came saying, please go down. They're already dead. Please, you might be hurt there. Go down, go down. As if he has not heard anything. 12 hours came. He's still what? Picking rocks from another stone to another stone. 12 hours, 24 hours came, even 32 hours, he's now feeling angry and feeling thirsty and feeling tired. He wanted to give up, but he still was not able to find his son. After 32 hours, he was able that when all hope seemed to be gone, he was able to find a deep cavern. And then he tried to shout, my son! My son! And there is an answer, yes, father! Yes, father, we are here! Are you okay there? Yes, father, we are okay! Okay, I will take you there. I will get you from there. And then he now take another pile of rock. And then he went deeper to get his child, to get his son. And then he was able to find out that there are many classmates that is with him at the place. And then he said, Father, please take them first before me. And then he took them one by one. He took them by the arms as if he was not tired, as if he was not hungry at the time. And then the last one is his son. And then as he is stretching his arms towards his son, he said, I am glad that you're okay. And the son said, yes, Father, I am very much okay. Because you know what? I told my classmates that you have said that you will come back and will fetch me. And that has been my hope because I know that you will come and fetch me. The same thing with God. We have been what? We have been covered by sins, by piles of sin. And we are being covered even to the deep cavern. But God is what? Trying to stretch His arms, trying to reach us down to bring us to Him. Because He has promised that He will come again. He will come again amidst those trials, my dear brothers and sisters. God has made an assurance that He will come again. And He, the one who has promised, is faithful to fulfill it. And He is more than excited than us. He is more than excited to meet us, to bring us home. And may we claim that promise until He comes. May we claim that promise until He comes. Heavenly Father, thank You that the end time will never be fearsome, but rather it will be a great joy for us because your promise of coming is making it closer and closer. Oh, dear God, we know that at this moment we are covered with piles of sin. And we within ourselves do not know how to get away or to get out of this sin. But dear Lord, please take away these piles of rocks from us. And give us a pure heart, dear loving Father, that we will see You face to face. May we be sealed by You, dear God, in the end times. May we be found prepared, dear loving Father. May we be found ready now and getting ready and staying ready until You come. Dear Lord, thank You for the promise that though we are covered with sin, Your grace will be sufficient and Your sacrifice is enough to take away the sin for each one of us. And we have the assurance that we will be found blameless because You will work through us and in us. Because You have promised that the one who has begun the good work will finish it until He comes. Thank You, dear loving Father. Thank You. Maybe some of us here are struggling with something. That's why his or her heart could not still be purified. It might be me, dear Lord. Please make me the first recipient of Your grace at this moment. May I be found as one of the wise virgins, not the foolish virgins. May I be found, dear Lord, trimming my lamps and keeping it burning for Your glory. And so, dear loving Father, may You seal our prayer and may this help us to be prepared more and more each day for Your soon return. Thank You so much, dear God, for the assurance that You will hear and answer our prayer because You are faithful to fulfill it for us. Because we ask all these things in the precious name of our Lord Jesus Christ, and for His glorious sake, let all God's people say, Amen. Amen. Good night, everyone, and may your names remain in the book of life. Good day.